Fellow Spartans, hello and welcome, and today I'm here to talk about Total War Attila, which has been announced last week on the 25th of September at EGX in London. So I'm just going to do a video just to talk to you about some of the features which have been announced and particularly caught my eye, just to go through them with you. And from there as well, obviously I want your feedback as well as always, so in the comments below tell me what your opinions are about the game and its announcement and the features that you particularly have liked the look of and things like that. So yeah, just anything you want to talk about Attila Total War, or Total War Attila I should say, then let me know down below. But yeah, I just want to do this video to go through this with you, because you haven't heard from my side of things, and it's good to share it with you guys, of course, as always. And a lot of other YouTubers have been doing so I thought I'd do it with you as well. Probably the things I'm going to go through with you, you know about already, but, you know, it's always good to share these things. So, one thing before I start, obviously, about going through the features of the game is the fact that, obviously, it was announced, as I say, last week at EGX in London. And I was fortunate enough to be actually down there on the day that it was announced on the 25th of September, because Creative Assembly amazingly invited me down there for the day. So I got to hang out with them, meet up with some of the Total War YouTubers, Rambler, Malekith, Diplex, Lionheart. It was a fantastic day, a really great time. So yeah, it's just amazing to be there, to feel it and to enjoy the atmosphere of the whole day, and to get a sense of what that sort of industry is like. It was just brilliant. I really had a great time. And as I was going down the train, I thought, you know what? This wouldn't be impossible without you guys. And I don't just say that for any reason. It generally, I think, is obviously because of you, a lot of it. Because, you know, 7 months ago, back in January, February of this year, I wasn't even doing YouTube. I was just playing Total War, for example, and any other games as well, for that matter. Just casually, on my own, on my computer. That was it. No more, no less. And here I am now, with my own YouTube channel, being asked by Creative Assembly to go down for the announcement of a new game, you know, being asked by them to be invited by them to go down to spend the day with them. Awesome. And that, as I say, is down to you guys for subscribing, for liking my videos, for commenting on my videos, and giving me that fantastic support that you have been doing. And by doing that, it's obviously helped, and Creative Assembly have obviously hopefully seen that as well. So just amazing. I thank you very, very, very much for that. I really do. I don't just say that, I really genuinely do. So thank you guys, each and every one of you. So what I did when I got down, I did a little bit of a vlog. It's my first time I've ever done a vlog, so it's a bit pants. Please don't shoot me. It was a bit amateur, but I thought I'd do this quick vlog for you. I've never done one before, just to get a bit of a feel for the day before the announcement of the game. So there's a few clips for you to enjoy now, just about 2 minutes long. So watch that. And I'll be back with you in a second, and we'll then talk about the features of the game in just a second. So enjoy this very amateur blog. Fellow Spartans, hello and welcome. And this is not my usual setting for a video. That is because I'm in the car. I'm on the way to the train station to get myself to London this morning, 25th of September, to visit the guys, Creative Assembly, who've asked me to come down to EGX London today for the announcement of the new Total War game, whatever that's going to be. I'm extremely excited. After I cannot wait. Hello, Ozzy. How are you doing? And what I'm going to be doing is going down today, get a flavour, get experience of what's going to be happening, try and capture that on my video today, do a bit of a vlog for you, and just try and get some reactions and speak to some of the guys there from the team at Creative Assembly. And of course, I'll be down there with some of the Total War YouTubers as well. So it's going to be a great day. Cannot wait to get there. It's going to be a really good experience. So I shall be back with you in a second once I've got myself down to London on the train. It will be a couple of seconds for you, but obviously it'll be a couple of hours for me. So I'll see you in just a second, and we shall have some more fun and tales on my videos. But before I go... Hello, Isabel! See you later! Okay, guys, I've just arrived in London. I'm here. And EGX bound, so got a bit about an hour and a half journey it was on the train in the end. Got a bit of a kit, so feel ready, feel pumped. So here we go. And another thing I want to do today is play on the Alien Isolation game, so I'm looking forward to playing on that at some point. So I shall see you in just a second. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I am here at EGX. There's Rambler, there's Lionheart. There's Izzy, the world-renowned Izzy on the forums. I love it. He's here. We're all having a great time.
I'm not even a YouTuber, people recognize me.
No, well, I don't care. I know you. The Total Wolf Army know you. Look around me. He's high. He's high on EGX.
I don't condone the use of drugs.
No, just the gaming drugs.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've been searched already, so that was fantastic. Yeah, the lady didn't even zip my bag up. She was that aggressive. But anyway, yeah, I'm here, we're having a good time, and I'm going to do some alien isolation in a bit. You going to do some alien isolation?
Yes.
Yes, we'll do it. See you later, guys. Hello, so I'm here.
Outside.
Here's Craig. Oh, he's Craig, he's Will. We've been talking about Craig all the time, that's right.
Look at this. Look at this ginger.
Aha, ginger.
Yeah, if I turn around too fast.
No. So I'm here with Lionheart and Will, and we're outside. We're going to go in a minute.
Yep. In a few seconds, we're going to be showing all of you guys what the next Total War's going to be.
So, we'll be back very soon with some more footage on whatever that will be.
Whatever could it possibly be?
Who knows?
The Eternal City. That glorious monument of power, culture, and learning. But the old wolf lies wounded by jackals, circled by vultures. Worried to death by a thousand tiny, vicious mouths brought low by your own arrows. These are the death throes of Rome. The light of civilization dims and gathers. And you've such precious time left to hide your women, for your children to cry. Even at the moment of your final defeat, you will take no comfort in oblivion. For I am coming for you. I ride with a million warriors. I bring the end of hate. I am the Scourge of Doom. And I will watch your world burn.
Yes, I knew it.
Yes! Okay, thanks for putting up with that. That was pretty horrendous, I'm sure you agree. But it's just, a quick flavour for you. And you got to love Rambler at the end. How excited was Rambler about the announcement of Attila Total War? He just got really excited. And that's something I've got to get used to. I'll just say it again, I'm going to say Attila Total War. It's Total War Attila. I've got to get used to that because obviously the franchise used to be the name and then Total War, like Napoleon Total War, but now it's changed it, hasn't it? It's now Total War and then the game itself. So Total War Attila. I'm talking about Napoleon. I think it's what this game is a little bit imaged, you know, mirrored to, I should say, because I think that's what they've gone down the same route as. You know, they've got Rome 2, they've got that base now, and I think with the Emperor Edition, we've got a much stronger and you know, a more secure base with that game now. It's improved a lot since its launch, definitely. And obviously then they built on that and given us Total War Attila, a bit like Empire, and then built on that to give us Napoleon Total War. And after the during the developer session, I got to make some notes about what I saw on the screen. You can see in the background now, this is my recording of the developer session. Bearing in mind, just to make sure you guys are aware, this is all pre-alpha footage. So this is subject to change. So, you know, we could see a lot of improvements from now until the day of its release. But as I say, yeah, I got to obviously sit there during the developer session. And then afterwards, I got to play the game as well. And I'll talk to you a bit about that after we talked about the features of what I saw on the announcement day. But yeah, some things have caught my eye. I just want to go through these with you. Some of them, as I say, you may not be aware of. You probably are aware of everything I'm going to talk about. But hey-ho. Just to recap, really, anything more than anything. So we know that the game is going to be launched in 2015. We know that. We don't know when. I suspect it could be either March or September, going from the previous releases we've had on Total War. I hope they do September, because obviously with it being September, it gives them a full year to concentrate on more of the game's development. So it won't feel like we'll get a rushed launch. because obviously with Total War Rome 2 it was slightly rushed and that's why it got the bad start. But if it gives them a full year, then they'll probably get it all smoothed out for its, you know, its launch and its release. And to be honest with you, I don't think Creative Assembly will make the same mistake twice. I think this launch will be a lot smoother. I've just got a good feeling about it. So we know that 2015. The game itself is set in 395 AD, so 395 AD. And it's sort of the dawn of the Dark Ages and the dawn of a lot of change in the world, especially the starting of the crumbling of the downward spiral of the Roman Empire. It's the start of it. The things are starting to get a little bit dodgy now. I think the Empire has got to that stage where it's getting a little bit too big to manage, basically, and the cracks are starting to appear. Now, we do know that at the moment, the West and the East, or Western and Eastern Roman Empires, will be playable factions on the game. So that initial challenge will be very difficult to manage that large landmass, especially with all these factions that are going to be challenging against you. For example, the Saxons, which are apparent on the game trailer or the game that we saw at the developer session. And there's a lot of mass migration of factions. The weather conditions, I believe, obviously play a big part of this game. During that time of history, there was a lot of climate change in the world. And so that plays a big part on the campaign. And that visually is there as well. So you'll get a greater sense of the different climates that are actually on the campaign map. So if you're in Britain, you'll feel very wet and it'll feel very windy and just, you know, dreary. And you'll see that visually on the campaign map, as opposed to if you're down in Libya, you know, in parts of North Africa, very hot climates, very bright, etc., very sandy conditions. And you'll see that a lot better than you would have done in previous Total War games. And of course, you're going to have to deal with the rise of Christianity now. Of course, that's becoming a major, contender in this game. The rise of Christianity as a religion across the known world is going to be something you're going to have to deal with, especially with the fact you've got your own, you know, specific cultures to deal with. At the same time, you've now got Christianity sweeping across to Europe, basically. So that's going to be a nice little addition and a different feature to deal with on the game itself. What else we got? Yes, so slightly larger map, I believe. So more to the east, obviously, with the Attila. And obviously, I know he's based in sort of Hungary, wasn't he, I believe, in modern-day Hungary. But that sort of, there's more sort of east on the campaign map, slightly more than we had before. So, you know, we could be hitting sort of modern-day Russia. And then to the north, we've got as well Sweden, small provinces in Sweden as well, I believe, that sort of area as well. So it goes a little bit north as well. It's gone north, so it's gone up there a bit. And there's better tabs. The UI has been improved, I think, from what I see. I think it's been improved. There's better information at hand to see straight away. There's better tabs, more information, and just a cleaner, sleeker, more streamlined approach to the UI, I think, definitely. At the same time, though, utilizing as much information that they can give to you as well at the same time. So a nice balance there between, you know, information and sleekness and, you know, and streamliners, basically. If that's the word, streamlined, I should say, basically. But better zoom on the map as well. Better zooming functionalities than before. So you can zoom right into the campaign map and go literally at ground level, or zoom right out, and you can get a much better overview of the campaign map. A higher, more satellite image view of the campaign map, basically. So that's going to be better for us to get an overall sense of where we are in the campaign. Greater textures have been implemented. Better lighting and shadows. More vegetation on the campaign map. Improved water textures. Better water textures. You know, more of a crispness in the water, say if you're down in calmer waters, or more choppy effect if you're in sort of the, windy, stormy seas, basically. So that is better. I mean, the whole campaign map looks a lot better. The textures have been improved a lot, I think. We get as well, as I said to you before, a greater sense of the climates, which we know about. As already mentioned that. The family tree. Wow, the family tree is back. Yes, we wanted that for a long time, and it's back on Attila. So basically, sorry, got to be excited then. So basically, yeah, family tree is back. You can now assign as well faction heirs to your family, which is great as well, because Medieval 2, you couldn't do that without a mod, but now you can actually set faction heirs again, which is great. You can also assign generals specific roles as governors, I believe, so maybe governor of Britannia. And obviously that would give you the generals more of a boost in their stats and things like that, and better abilities on the battlefield. And, you know, it will then as well, I believe, that whole general sort of feel of the general management or generals managing the generals, let's say, there we go, has been improved. So you get more traits, more a feel of more of a story behind the man, behind the general, basically, if you get what I mean. So it makes you feel that that general is important. And if you lose that general, you've lost a great man in your faction. More so than your generic generals in Rome 2. That actually is a bit more of a feel of wanting to keep the general alive now with all his traits and his abilities. And so it gives you that more of a story behind him. And that was very much apparent again in Medieval 2. And I think they brought that a lot back in Attila. So that's good. They've obviously given that a lot of work to it. What as well? Yeah, it's better event management. This is, again, is a big thing for me, because on Rome 2, you'd have your events in a list, and after about 20, 25 turns, the events would go, they'd disappear, and you wouldn't know what they were. They'd just go into distant memory. But they're back. They are back now, but they're back permanently. Okay, so I believe any event that happens on the campaign or the battle map will stay on the campaign event log, okay, and you can now filter them into specific areas of the game. So you could have like events just around campaign declaration of wars or peace, and you could have events about just your specific faction events that could have occurred, maybe a death of a general, death of a wife or your leader or something like that. So they will be filtered off into different areas of the event log now. So nicely managed, but again, you've got everything there to hand. So it creates that better story of, that element of story of your faction, basically. Okay, which is great. And of course, you can apparently as well now share your stats online as well. So if you've got your campaign and the stats that you produced during that campaign, you can now load that up online and share that with your friends across the internet as well. A nice little feature that adds a bit of more competitiveness. Oh my god, more competitiveness, if I can say that right, to the campaign. I can't get my words out today. Horrendous. Where are we then? Better building management as well. That is better. You can see the whole building chain on one screen. It's not sort of a case of having to try and search for it in encyclopedias. I believe it's all there on hand to look at in sort of a one window screen. Excellent. And talking about that as well, the tech tree has got that same approach being added to it as well. One window. All the tech tree and researches are under one screen as opposed to different subscreens like it was in Rome 2. So that, again, has been streamlined and improved. Diseases can play a bigger part in the game now, I believe. So diseases can start in your city. Say if you had high levels of squalor, that could then start the spreading of a disease, which would then could carry across the land and into your armies. And eventually, hopefully, it could go into your enemy's armies as well. And obviously, then they would suffer from attrition at the same time. So again, that has been improved, more dynamic than it was before. And this is one is a big one. Yeah, this one is a big one. I've got my notes here. This one is a great feature they've added on, brand new to the Total War series. And that is the abandonment of cities. So, if you don't know what it is, you've probably seen it on the screen already in the video, because I did record that section on the screen. But I'll explain it to you a little bit more. So, if you're not aware of what this feature is, basically what it is say you had a city which is no way you're going to be able to defend that city. It's going to be taken by the enemy no matter what, and they've got the enemy approaching to take that city. So instead of trying to hold off and trying to fight it out with your garrison army and losing it, and then they acquire it and obviously gain the benefits from holding that city, what you can do is, if you have an army there already, you retreat that army back to a strong position on your campaign map where you can consolidate and push back outwards again after a while. What you do is you retreat them back, but at the same time, you then completely abandon the city, and then the land after the end turn phase is completely left desolate. So all the advantages of that land, all the resources that it possibly could have had as well, will be gone, removed. So the invading army will not reap the benefits from acquiring that land from you. So they will be in a weaker position because they're now stretched out further from their homeland without any base of resources or recruitment or any way of being able to, there'd be no way of the army or the enemy being able to replenish their troops either. So a little bit better and improved on that. So again, a great feature that they've added to the game, and yeah, a really nice addition that will add so much more options to your strategic play and how you manage that on the game. So definitely improved. Now moving on to the actual battles now on the campaign, on the battle map, not the campaign. That's sort of what I talked to you about there, was more of the campaign features. Now we'll move on to the battle itself and what the battles, how they've been improved on the game. So they've had massive work done and concentration done on their sieges. So the sieges now on Total War Attila have been massively improved. And one of the main features of that in sieges is now what we call siege escalation. So every time you siege a city, either you or the enemy siege you, and they siege you for a set amount of turns, they are then represented in levels of siege escalation. So the longer you siege a city, the higher the level of siege escalation it becomes, and that then is represented on the camp. I'm sorry, I say the campaign map, on the battle map. So then, for example, if you're at the highest level of siege escalation, like we saw on this siege of Londinium, the walls will be caved in. There'll be no walls standing really. Towers would have been destroyed. Homes and buildings, you know, just completely annihilated. Smoke and fire around the battle map, fire being a major player now, I'll come to that in a second. Fire in the battle map and just complete desolation of the land, basically. And if you're at lower levels of the siege escalation, say you just went in and attacked the city straight away without any sieging of it, or any, you know, yes, holding out on the city for a number of turns, the city will be complete. You'd have the walls, buildings will be fine, everything. It'll be a lot cleaner and better looking. But if you get down to nitty-gritty of siege escalation, it could get pretty bad quickly, basically. So that's a lovely feature that they've added to the game. And because of that now, because you've got siege escalation and obviously gaps in the walls and things like that which will appear, you can now use barricades and actually have battle deployments on the cities themselves. So you could have like a barricade put up across an opening or an alleyway in the city. And with that barricade being up, it would allow you to funnel the enemies down another way on the battle map, I should say, in the city. Funnel them down that area of the map where you want them to go, and then you can attack them and concentrate attacking them at points that you want to get them at. So it draws them into your sort of where you want to strategically get them, basically. Of course, the enemy can break down those barricades eventually with enough firepower and might, but obviously it'll take its time, which will give you maybe the time to fire your artillery against them. But, you know, that is possible from the enemy's perspective as well. And mentioning about fire is now dynamic. This is a lovely feature. Fire now spreads across your city. So it won't just stay stagnant and at one particular building if it's caught fire. It will spread, and it will spread like wildfire, basically. Pardon the pun there, but it will spread like wildfire. And it will actually have a direct effect on your army's morale. And you'll have an indicator at the top of your screen, which will go from green to amber to red. Green being okay, amber getting bad, red bad. So that will give you different levels of morale penalties to your army, which will then in turn cause your armies to retreat and waver a lot quicker. So if your fire's doing okay, it's not spreading that much, it will stay green. And as the fire gets worse, it will spread, and the indicator will go from amber to green, so from green to amber to red. You get what I mean. So there you go. And you obviously get an indicator of what that penalty, or how much that penalty is costing your army, basically. So that's a nice feature as well. Now, talking about nice features, this one for me is something I've wanted for a long time. It may sound ridiculously stupid and small to you guys, but to me, I've wanted it for a long time. And that is civilians on the battle map. Wow, this is just going to be ace. Basically, if you remember, obviously, of course you would have done, most of you guys would have played Rome 1. If you played Rome 1, on the settlement tab on the campaign map, there's a button where you could magnify it, I think, and you could go on. I don't know if you could do this on Medieval 2, but on Rome 1, you could go into the city and have a bird's eye view of the city. As it, you know, not in a war, not in a battle, but it's peacefully go around the city and look at your monuments and your buildings. And when you were doing that, civilians would walk around the city. enjoying themselves, basically. And I always thought to myself, why don't they have that on the actual battles themselves? Because the civilians wouldn't really go unless it was really bad. And he did mention that, actually. If you're at the highest level of siege escalation, by that point, the civilians would have probably left because they know it's getting pretty bad and they would have abandoned the city. But at lower levels, they won't have done. And so by doing that, you will have civilians either trying to run for their lives into buildings. They will be obviously farming on the land if it was just the start of the battle. And even more so, if they were to come across the enemy, they may stand and fight and try and take on the enemy. They probably won't last for very long, but God, they'll give it a go. Adds a bit of immersion, doesn't it? Adds a bit more dynamic effects. Makes it a bit more dynamic on the gameplay and the battle. I like it. I think it's very good that they've done that. And a really welcome addition. So I hope to see that one in the game. Because obviously you couldn't see it on this battle because it was the highest level of siege escalation, as I say. But if we can see that going forward, that would be fantastic. And as well, he said that obviously there's persistent damage on the campaign and battle map. So if you were to, for example, at this battle, you would have fired out, you won the battle, you drove the enemy away, you didn't repair any of your buildings, and then the enemy came back again, then and they attacked you once more, they'll be able to attack the city directly again as it was before, because the walls would have been destroyed still and nothing would have been repaired. So that visually would have not changed on the battle map at all. So they mentioned that as well. And what else? Yes, better particle effects apparently on the in battle game. So they've been added on, improved. And with that, MSAA has been added on as well. MSAA, which we've been lacking on Rome 2. So that's going to give that smoother, sharper edge effect to the game and its graphics. That's been added back on. And with the particle effects being improved, you see that visually in a lot of ways. Firstly, the trees can now catch fire. So with your buildings, them catching fire and obviously making a morale effect and to your armies and spreading dynamically. Now trees will catch fire in and out of the battle city. So they will, you know, catch fire in the farmlands and the fields as well. And with that, they've improved, I think, the trail effects. So when your artillery is firing and you've got fire on your arrows, they will leave a smoke trail across the battle map, which is obviously done for a number of games, but it looks more realistic in this battle, in this battle that we saw on Attila Total War. So I think Total War Attila, there we go again. But I think it looks better on this battle map. It looks more effective, more immersive, and gives you that sort of battle feel that you should have if thousands of arrows and artillery are firing across the sky at one point. It gives that more of an epic feel to it. But what they've done as well is they've added trail effects, I think, too much to the arrows. So if they weren't firing fire arrows, just firing normal arrows, there's a big, thick, white trail that's going across at the moment. And I think they need to reduce that down because I think it's a bit too intense for just normal arrow fire. And I think hopefully they will do that, or at least give us the option to turn those trails off, I hope. Because at the moment they look a bit too intense for me. And you guys comment below and tell me your thoughts. But I think they look a bit too intense at the moment. And I believe as well they've added axe animations in correctly this time from what I saw. The Saxon warriors who had the axes were using them correctly, not trying to jab people like a sword. So that looks like they've improved that on the game as well. And that's all really that I saw that really stood out for me. A lot of improvements, I think, to the battle and the campaign map. But at the same time, you know, nice additions to the game as well. But the most important thing for me is the fact that we get a streamlined, nice, smooth release that's going to be, you know, good and effective to use from the launch. And I hope CA will do that and they've learned from their mistakes with Rome 2. I suspect we won't see the same error come twice. I really don't. Especially when we saw Empire in that release and then Napoleon had a better release and a better game than what Empire was. And as I said to you earlier, I did get to play the game, the battle itself, firsthand after the actual developer session. And I felt very happy from what I saw. Visually as well, I wasn't conned in any way. You know, when we saw the Siege of Carthage a couple of years ago for Rome 2 and then what we saw it as when it came out, it was a bit different, wasn't it? You can hold your hands up and agree with me on that one. But from what I saw on Attila Total War Attila, thank you. It felt right. It looked very it looked fantastic. It looked exactly like it did on the developer session. Those graphics were really, really stunning, and the lighting and everything was just superb, and it flowed very nicely. There wasn't any lag. It was very smooth. I think the optimization will be there this time. I was talking to Craig afterwards, and he said to me, obviously, they're using the Warscape engine, and from that, they've developed it and enhanced it a lot more for Total War Attila. And, you know, what they'd have done, I'm sure, is use Rome 2 as its base now, which they've got it right, or they've got it a lot better, I should say, than they had at launch. It's a lot more optimized than it was at launch as well, and they've obviously built upon that and improved things a lot. So there you go. I think we're going in the right direction. I think the game will flow better. As I say, the whole feel of the soldiers moving, the battle map, their impact, especially when what I did notice was the cavalry. When they charge and impact into the infantry lines, it felt more of an impact, and it charged. The cavalry charged better. It moved better from what I could see visually. So I think the whole game is going to be a good experience for us. The battle time limits will last longer. I think the actual engagements will hold out for longer, like they are doing now in Rome 2 with the Emperor Edition coming out. Those engagements will last longer, and you'll get more of a feel of an epic battle than you did maybe at the beginning of Rome 2 when it was first released. So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. I thought I'd just share this with you. I look forward to it massively. I can't wait to play it. I will definitely obviously be doing Let's Plays on it when it comes out, whenever that will be, next year. And I hope at some point maybe that Creative Assembly, you know, if they do, it would be amazing. If they can give me some maybe preview access to it, I can play it before it's released and get a general idea of what the game's going to be like. It would be amazing if I got that. Obviously, who's to say either way? That may happen, it may not. I don't know. But it'll be AC they did. But we'll, you know, at least we can get the game when it comes out for sure. And I'll definitely do some Let's Plays on it at least. So that will definitely happen. So, guys, there we go. There's my thoughts and opinions from what I saw so far. Any updates to the game that I get, any big updates, I will try and release another video at that point to update you with some more announcements to the game as they come out. Because, as you say, they will be announcing more things throughout the coming months. And, of course, your feedback, your opinions, I want to hear them as well. So in the comments below, tell me what you think about the game and what you thought about the announcement and the setting of the game as well. So thanks for watching, guys. Please remember to comment, rate, and subscribe as always. Give me a big thumbs up for the video if you want. And always be sure to check me up on Facebook and Twitter. And, of course, my Steam group, The Heroes of Sparta. But until next time, this is Warrior Sparta. For now, saying goodbye.